So the portion that was in my mind was from Luke's Gospel chapter 8, and it's a very familiar incident. It is about the woman who had an incurable illness was healed by Jesus. And so that is the story that we are going to look into. Sometime back, I think around this week only, I think all of you would have seen a video which happened in US because of the riots and all the other things going on in US. And you would have seen these two police cars ramming into people because they were blocking their way. They basically surrounded that police car, and instead of being the protection of people, they were the ones again hitting the people. So it was quite a sight to see. So, you know, Jesus asked a question to the woman who touched Jesus, "Who touched me?" Okay. And if we look at that question in the current sense, you know, it is like, you know, you're traveling in a bus and there's like a lot of people around you who is, you know, pushing you, crushing you. And it's kind of an offensive way of telling to others, "Hey, who touched me?" That statement is that which something that God spoke to me. Okay, so we need to understand, are we on the offensive or are we ready to forgive? That is a big question in front of us. You know, many times we are on the offensive. We want to prove ourselves that we are right or we have not done wrong, and we want justice and all those things. And that is what the world fights for. And we have seen many times that's what even believers sometimes forget what Jesus did on the cross, and many of them, they fight for their rights. So we'll come to a story, this incident about this woman who was ill. Now, prior to this incident is where we see about the demon-possessed man in that place called Gerasenes was healed by Jesus. And after that incident, Jesus crosses to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and he comes back to this place. And here, once he lands back, there is a person waiting for him. And that person happens to be the person by the name of Jairus, a leader of the synagogue. He's waiting there for Jesus to land there so that he can take Jesus to his home to heal his sick daughter. And as this man is, we see that in verse 41 of chapter 8, then a man named Jairus, a leader of the local synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come home with him. His only daughter, who was about 12 years old, was dying. This was quite an intense scene, because this was a father with the only child, only daughter, who was about to die. And we can understand what all emotions that father is going through. And he wants to save his daughter. And he knows that Jesus can do that very well. But as soon as Jesus lands there, there's a huge crowd that has surrounded him. Basically, in some translation, it mentions that they were like literally crushing him. That was the so many people had surrounded Jesus. And we see that as Jesus goes with Jairus to his house to heal his daughter, and on the way this incident is happening. So we see that there's a lot of people who have surrounded Jesus. Probably many people, they want to be healed or they want to be there. And also this man Jairus, being the leader of a local synagogue, he would have a lot of followers. And as we see that when they go, as Jesus goes to his house, we see there's a lot of people there also, maybe part of his relatives, part of the synagogue. So many people are there. So as Jesus is walking through this crowd, we see a hand coming and touching the dress of Jesus. And that we read in verse 44. Coming up behind Jesus, she touched the fringe of his robe. Immediately, the bleeding stopped. Now, we need to understand what this woman went through throughout this year. Surprisingly, again, we read at 12 there. We see that the age of Jairus' daughter is 12 years. And we see the woman had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. That was her sickness. So we see that this woman, she was a sick woman and she was a suffering woman. She was an unclean woman. And also we see that she was a poor woman. And her sickness was, she had a constant bleeding. And if we read the parallel verses in Mark's Gospel chapter 5, we read that she, Mark's Gospel chapter 5, and verse 26, we see that she had suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years she had spent everything she had to pay them, but she had gotten no better. In fact, she had gotten worse. Now, if we try to understand her sickness, you know, her problem is compounded by the way she is viewed by Jewish law as ceremonially unclean. Women were normally considered unclean during their period. But more than this was her problem. Her problem was not the monthly problem. Hers was a continuous problem for the last 12 years. If we read Leviticus chapter, in Leviticus 15 and verse 25 and to 27, we read about what God had to say about this and or what Moses commanded. There it is written, when a woman has a discharge of blood for many days at a time, other than her monthly period, or has a discharge that continues beyond her period, she will be unclean as long as she has the discharge, just as in the days of her period. And here it mentions that in the last verse, verse 27, whoever touches them will be unclean. She must wash his clothes and bath with water, and he will be unclean till evening. There is a mention of both men and women about uncleanness. And whoever she would have touched would have become unclean. So that was her state. It was not a monthly thing for her. For her, it was a terrible condition. For the last almost 12 years, she was suffering from this sickness. And she was an unclean woman. Her state would have been as similar as that of a leper, I believe, who could never be touched, who would have just, when he would be passing by, he would be just telling, unclean, unclean. I think that was the same state of this woman. And she would have been in total isolation, we believe. You know, anyone who knew about her illness would shun her. They wouldn't like to come near her. You know, we are seeing that very well these days, you know, due to this coronavirus. Many people who have this virus, they don't want to tell others. Thinking that others may isolate them, they may think wrongly about them, and all these things. And people, they don't, we ourselves wouldn't like to come near to such a person. Here the case was about a traditional thing, about a ceremonially unclean person, you know, and she could never go into the temple. She would never come into a synagogue, and her illness would have resulted in her isolation. She couldn't go about in society and mingle in the marketplace with other women, since a touch from her would make someone unclean. She couldn't attend ceremonial occasions or synagogue worship, and so she resorts to secrecy. Probably she isn't even known in Capernaum. She comes incognito, her condition carefully concealed, but she comes with determination. Her life was a solitary life. It would have been a secret life. She herself would be trying to hide herself from people so that others may not think that she is an unclean woman. And she wouldn't mingle with those people in the marketplace or even with her own society. She was living a totally solitary life. And we saw that she, for treating this, she would have gone to many doctors. You know, like these days when, you know, for example, we knew the our second one, Cheryl, was not well, when she had the skin allergy. Everywhere we went, whether we traveled on flights, whether we were in airports or we were in hospitals, other places, countless people, they would just look at her and they would say, oh, we know a doctor here, they can treat her. Oh, you take allopathy, you take Ayurveda, you take homeopathy, and all this. So many suggestions people they told out of love, not because they were they were troubling us in any way. But I'm saying that many people same like that would have suggested to this woman also, who was suffering from 12 years with such a serious sickness, an incurable sickness. So many doctors would have given her medicines and other things, and it wouldn't have healed her. It hadn't healed her in any way. So she was totally in a very bad state and shunned by society. We know that what happens to women normally, or any men who are suffering from such sickness where blood is oozing out of them, or if they are having some skin allergy, you wouldn't like to look at that face, and many people they wouldn't even like to come near that person, and that would have been this woman's state. But we see that this woman was a very hopeful woman. She knew that she had to be healed. So when she knew about Jesus coming to this shore, that great hymn writer who wrote, William Hunter, he wrote that song, "The great physician now is near, thus sympathizing Jesus. He speaks the drooping heart to cheer or hear the voice of Jesus." She had been to so many physicians, but she had never got a healing. But here she was with she knew about this great physician who was going to come. And when the great physician actually lands there, he is actually going to Jairus' house. And this woman, her only intention is at least if she touches the fringe of the robe of Jesus, she would be healed. And we, as I said, that when Jesus landed on the shore, there was Jairus waiting for Jesus. So that he, as I said, he was literally begging Jesus to come and heal his daughter. Okay. And when all these things happen, we see that this lady, or this woman, she sees that boat coming. She spots the boat and the crowd waiting. And she sees Jairus prostrating himself before Jesus, begging to his daughter's life. She's not far away. But when Jesus begins to move through the crowd toward Jairus' house, she is not far behind. She is just waiting. Anyhow, there is so much crowd surrounding Jesus. She wants to touch the robe of Jesus. And we see the picture here. Probably down below the legs of some people, she would have crawled, so that nobody else would identify who she was. She would have been probably covering her face. We don't know. And she just anyhow wants to touch the robe of Jesus. And we can understand, because she has this flow of blood, she would have been very weak. Her strength would have been totally drained. But yet she did not give up. She wanted to anyhow reach unto Jesus to touch touch that robe of Jesus. She had decided, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. That's what Mark's Gospel 5 verse 28 it reads. If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. That was the faith in her. And here we see that she doesn't want to confront him in public. She is too ashamed to admit the nature of her illness, and perhaps even be rebuked for mingling with others in her unclean state. She must do this without revealing anything, but she must touch Jesus, and she must do it for her healing. In verse 46 of Luke's Gospel chapter 8, we read that the moment she touched Jesus, verse 45, Jesus asked, "Who touched me?" Everyone denied it, and Peter said, "Master, this whole crowd is pressing up against you." And we read, but in verse 46, we read, Jesus said, "Someone deliberately touched me, for I felt healing power go out from me." Jesus is asking that question, "Who touched me?" And Peter is replying, "The whole crowd is actually pressing you. Why you are asking this question? Who touched you?" But Jesus is telling, "Someone deliberately touched me. Somebody with great faith has touched me." Actually in Luke's Gospel chapter 6 verse 19, we read, verse 19, everyone tried to touch him because healing power went out from him and he healed everyone. Many people, just for the sake of being healed, they would have come to just touch Jesus. But here we read, Jesus actually tries to identify who that person is. And verse 48, Jesus tells, once he identifies who this woman is, Jesus tells, daughter, he said to her, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Do we deliberately touch Jesus? You know, that is a great question that we have. Sometime back in Ahmedabad, I had taken a Bible study on the friend at midnight. You know, in that the same thing. There is two incidents. In one is in chapter 11, verse 5 to 8. Another is in 18, 1 to 8. We read about the unjust judge as well. In both cases, we see the persistence. They were so persistent of getting a help from that other person. And so when we think about this woman, Jesus is telling, someone deliberately touched me. And that's the faith that God is expecting from us, where we deliberately come to him and touch him. Not when just when we are sick, or not just when we are happy or joyful, not when everything is gone from us. That's the time when we come to him. But every moment of our life, every morning, we need to come deliberately to the feet of Jesus to touch him, to get comfort from him, to get encouragement from him, to get a new hope in our life for facing that day. And that's what God is expecting to our life. Now, when we think, why has Jesus exposed our secret? You know, Luke's account doesn't tell us, but I see two reasons for that. The first step is, as I said, in Luke 6 verse 19, we see that many people actually touched Jesus to get healed. Okay. But here there was a big difference. Jesus wanted to identify her among the people, that woman who had touched her. This is the first step in removing the terrible burden of uncleanness from the woman. Jesus accepts her. He isn't angry. He blesses her with God's peace. He tenderly calls her daughter. This both helps restore her own self-esteem, but also her standing in the community if she is from Capernaum. He is clarifying what had happened so that it wouldn't fall into the realm of magic and superstition. Your faith had healed you, he acknowledges. Her faith surely wasn't in his clothing. It was in God's working through Jesus. The clothing didn't impart healing, he's saying. Her faith in God has brought that about. So when we think about the woman, as I said initially, this woman would have been in isolation. There would have been no relatives for her, no friends for her. She couldn't go to the temple. She couldn't go to the synagogue. And she lived a very secret life. And she would have been away from all the marketplaces for maybe for all her purchases that she had to do. She would be doing it very secretly. But here Jesus wanted to expose her to the public, that now she was no more an unclean person, but she was a clean person. That's what God does in our life. Once upon a time, we were unclean people. We had gone away from God. We were in hiding. In no way we could come into the holy presence of God. But when God healed us, he has removed that uncleanness from us. Now we need not be in hiding. We need to come out to tell others that God, what God has done in our life, that God has restored us. God has made us different. And now we can move and walk on this earth with great confidence and without being discouraged of what is happening around us and all those things. And God has elevated us to a higher state. Now we need not live that solitary life. Now we can live a life with confidence, knowing that God is with us. You know, if we see her healing as a result of her faith, she was made whole of her illness. Jesus did not say to her, thy faith hath healed thee, but thy faith hath made thee whole. Her faith did not just heal her, but it completely changed her. She was completely made well. It was not just that particular sickness, but her faith had made her completely whole. It had brought her into the true relationship with God, with Jesus Christ. When the Lord heals us from sin, he makes our entire person whole. Her issue of blood ceased. Her fear and isolation from the community had ended. She was made whole in body, soul, and spirit. She could now join the community of Israel and make her appearance in the temple of God. That's what the Lord desires for each of us when we come to Him to be made whole. We need to make our healing or the removal of our uncleanness, removal of our sin from our life, made public to the people. We see that when this woman was healed, verse 47, we read, when the woman realized that she could not stay hidden, she began to tremble and fell to her knees in front of him. The whole crowd heard her explain why she had touched him and that she had been immediately healed. You know, if we see some of the videos of, you know, these people who rescue dogs who would have been trafficked or who had been treated badly, many times we see that when they actually go to rescue that dog literally doesn't want to come out of its hiding place. It just wants to be there. Probably it would have been badly bruised, but it does, it, out of fear and trembling, it is just inside. It doesn't want to come outside. And we see this woman, for the last 12 years, she was a suffering woman. She had been to many places to get her healing done. And she would have lost all her money to all the physicians she had approached to. And she would have been, that's what we read here, you know, that she began to tremble and fell to her knees in front of him. She thought, probably for a little moment of time, she would have thought, comparing Jesus to another Pharisee, who would have rebuked her for being there at that place and making others unclean. But she realized this was not like other teachers or other Pharisees or other rabbis. This was Jesus, who was way different, who came to clean the unclean people, who came to restore the unclean people. He did not come to rebuke them or to destroy them or to call them unclean, but he came to clean those people. And that's what we see in Jesus. So we need to ask this question this evening to us ourselves. Do people want to touch us or are being touched by us? This is a very important question that, you know, that I was pondering on. Are we approachable? Can the believers in our assembly or can the people in the society that we live in, are we living a life that they can easily approach us for any help when they are sick, when they are in need? You know, sometimes we need to correct that in our life. You know, many times we think too much about ourselves and it is a hindrance for many people to understand the love of God in our lives. To taste that love of God in our life, it is very difficult for them because many times our attitude or our hypocritical life stops other people from coming and touching us and be blessed. We would be great preachers in the pulpit or making long prayers in meetings. But does that make us approachable by people? We see many instances that people, they don't want to approach us because they know that they may get a negative answer from us. So this was what God talked to me. Am I living a life, or as a family, as an individual, am I living a life that I am easily approachable so that a brother who has a doubt in the scripture can easily call me and ask me that answer? Or if somebody is sick, somebody wants to go to a hospital, or somebody is in an emergency, can they call me and I am available all the time, even at midnight? Am I living that life? Or am I staying away from such people? That's what God wanted to teach me through this incident. The second is, are we being touched by us? Are people being touched by us? When we meet people, when we say a word, a gracious word, does it teach people? Does it encourage people? There was a brother in our assembly here. He was from another faith. I still remember that he was not born and brought up in brethren culture and not used to the worship format that the brethren people had. So at times we would see that he would say a long testimony during the worship time. And I found that many people found it very irritating. But I will tell you something. When I used to listen to that brother, the testimony that he spoke, it made my heart flow to worship God all the more, because that person, whatever testimony he told, it was like, you know, just tears, you know, falling out of his eyes, and his heart's melting of what, how God is good, had been so good to him, and how God had been so kind to him. And that was really encouraging. So we need to check our lives, that are we touching other people? Are we a help to other people? Maybe we are not great speakers in the assembly, or great ministers in the assembly. We are silent people, but many of the ministries that we do in the backstage is very important in the eyes of God. That makes us more approachable for other people, to other people. So we need to ask this question this evening. Do people want to touch us, or are being touched by us? You know, we saw that first scene where the police car is ramming into people. And we saw the second scene where some of the protesters, they came one of the police stations, the sheriff and all his policemen, they came out and they bowed in solidarity. They were like literally asking forgiveness from the people. On one side, some people were telling about taking revenge on the protesters, using force, and other people. On the other side, we see that they came out and they said, yes, one of our person made a mistake and we are sorry for that. That made me ask this question. Are we pointing finger at someone or standing with our whole team and acknowledge that we made a mistake and restoring those who are lost? Many times in our community or in our church, if somebody makes mistake against another, we start pointing, hey, you should not have done like that. You did a mistake. But we need to understand that we are the body of Christ. If any of our brother makes a mistake, we need to understand that mistake or that pain is to the body of Christ. And we need to look at that particular incident as a whole team. Maybe some person went on the wrong way, backslided, did something, some awful sin. But rather than pointing finger why he made that mistake or why he did that wrong, God was teaching me that we need to look at it like a whole team. Not like the many organizations, they teach about team building and other stuff. This is not, this is much more beyond that. This is the body of Christ, which Christ bought us with his precious blood, and where he is the head. And we are all part of that body of Christ. When anyone makes mistake, when anyone does, we need to acknowledge that it is we who made that mistake, and we need to restore those who are lost. The second question, one more question is, are we resisting to the problems of people or allowing it to conduct into our lives too? As I said, this woman, her problems would have been resisted by all the teachers, all the Pharisees and the high priests and the rabbis. They would have resisted to her problem. They didn't want her to come near them. They would have said, go away from us. Don't come near to us. We have nothing. We have no part with you. You are an unclean person. You need to stay away. And probably they would be thinking, this is some God's judgment on her. And they would have, you know, isolated her and made her go away. And many times we see that same attitude in the church as well, where we are resisting to the problems of people. We see that many youths today, they are going away from faith. And we immediately try to, you know, by force, hey, what you're doing is wrong. And many times we teach the wrongs, only the wrongs, but we don't teach them what are the rights and what is the right way. We forget to teach them. Many times we are resisting their problems. Their questions we are resisting. You know, we think, oh, they are very modern, or it is not what our forefathers taught us. But we need to align with the problems that they are facing, because our children, our next generation is facing a problem which is much more beyond what we faced. It is much more beyond that. So we need to ask this question. Are we resisting to the problems of people or allowing it to conduct into our lives too? Here we see in this woman's life that Jesus was ready to come in touch with her and make sure that her problem was his problem, and he was going to heal her and restore her. so that she could lead a normal life after that. So that's what I wanted to speak today evening. God's word, the few things that God taught me, you know, where the first thing was, do people want to touch us or are being touched by us? We need to ask this question to ourselves. The second is, are we pointing finger at someone or standing with our whole team or our whole church and acknowledge that we made a mistake and restore those who are lost? Are we resisting to the problems of people? Are we going on an offensive? Or are we standing there with our hands spread out in love to accept the people who have done wrong and to accept them back and show them the way back, allowing it to conduct into our lives too and allowing them or giving them an opportunity for them to come back to us? And one of the verse that reads in Luke's Gospel chapter 8 verse 50. Verse 48. Daughter, he said to her, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. And that's what God did in this woman's life. Not only did he heal her, but he restored her. He made her completely well. May God's name be glorified through these words this evening.
Request Naveen to pray and thereafter we'll have the Bible quiz. Naveen, can you hear us? Naveen?
Can't see him, no? Is he on?
No, he's on and his mic is also unmute. Yeah. We'll request Brother Chintan to pray. Brother Christy Chintan.
Hello.
Yes. Naveen?
I can hear you.
Okay, go ahead. Okay.
ब्रेक करी दे आलू पिता, हम आपका धन्यवाद देते हैं। आपने अपने पवित्र रोशनों से बातें किया, इसलिए हम आपका धन्यवाद देते हैं। और हमने देखा प्रभु कि हमारे जीवन में से किस प्रकार गलतियां होती हैं, हम दूसरों के लिए दूर जाने के कारण या तो फिर उनके आपके पास आने का कारण बन जाते हैं पिता परमेश्वर। लेकिन हम धन्यवाद देते हैं पिता परमेश्वर, जो आपके पवित्र वचन में से सुना गया। हमारी प्रार्थना है कि उसके अनुसार हमारा जीवन हो और बहुतों के बचाने के कारण हम भी अपने जीवन के द्वारा आपके उस प्रेम को दिखा सके, हम आपसे प्रार्थना करते हैं। स्वर्गीय पिता, जो आज आपका वचन सुना गया, इसके लिए हम आपका धन्यवाद देते हैं। प्रार्थना हमारे आत्मिक जीवन में काम करे और हम भी वैसा जीवन जी कर आपकी वही मगर पाए। सारी बातें आपके चरणों में सौंपते हैं। प्रार्थना प्रभु यीशु के नाम से कबूल करें पिता। आमीन।
आमीन।